Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Night Bridge. I'm Racist to You. Hello. It is November 12th, 2019. This is the pre-show. This is the warm-up. This is our little... Before we start the show. Hello, everybody. How's it going? On a Tuesday night. Hello, everybody. Can I get a hi in the chat? Say hi to me. Tell me hello to the chat. I'm going to say it back to you. Reggie33, hello. Norfdog, yo, what's up, man? Dwayne, hello. Howdy to Wabbit Magic. Grumman Jeff, hello. WWTPS, hi. Iberobitosis, hello. Crimson Zamboni, Jedi71, hello. Wabbit Magic and Thalcott, hello. Fast Anomalies, hi. Mechaholic, hi. Atatuma, hi. Not hi. I've forgotten. I haven't listened to that Sharkle video in a minute, so. I have forgotten what he sounds like. Hola to M. Bloom, Johan B. Hello, or Johan N. B. I don't know. Bob Kelly, hello. E. Clay Thompson, Dead for Me, Skill Cats, hello, hello, hello. Rock Roll Martin, Thermos Jack, Reject, hello. Sherwin Rocks, hi, hi, hi. Hot Beverages, hi. Annalisa, hello. Meryl Barr, The Buck, hi, everybody. Water Rice, Scoops, hello. Vast Anomaly says, VCU, go Rams, go. Go Rams, go Rams. Let's see, Speed Demon, hello, hello, hello. BioCow, hello. Chopper 42, hello. Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us here on the Night Hack Pre-Show. We're going to start the show at the top of the hour, but this is the pre-show. Now, I do know that Brian Brushwood said he would be here at like 5 till. It is now 12. So... Meryl Barr asks, are you wearing a Snuggie? No, this is a hoodie. This is an Empire brand hoodie from, what was it, Zoomies? I think I got it at Zoomies. I think I got this last year or very early this year, right before it got warm, and then it was impractical to wear it. HTTP asks, am I sick from eating warm water? No, I did not have any of the warm water. No part of me was going to have that water. The guys did. The guys had it. And more or less, they seemed okay with it. No one got sick. Jason didn't love it, but but they made it through. They made it through. It is. In fact, we recorded another video about making water. Probably a few weeks ago, we're distilling water. We can't distill liquor in Texas because we don't have a license to do so, and you need one. But we can still use a distiller, so we distilled water out of something else, and that was a fun episode. It took a little while. It did take a little while to shoot. And that one's coming. I don't know how soon that one's coming out because we just had the one where they filtered out. They did like survival filtering of water today. So I don't quite know how soon after that one we'll put this one out. But it was also a collaboration video, so there's someone else in that. So who knows? Who knows? Hello, everybody. I am drinking a PepsiCo brand Mountain Dew. There's not a cider in here. And you know what? I deserved it. You know what? Actually, I deserve a little soda. I'm not cutting out soda, and I'm certainly not making the switch to Diet Coke. But I'm just trying to be a little more intentional about when I have soda. So I try to keep it to just when I'm having meals. So I'm like not snacking with it, but. My credo has been that nobody was really interested in anybody else's personal exercise plan. But I did really fucking crush it today on the Ring Fit adventure. That's 50 minutes of active time. That was 2 hours of real time. 195 calories, 2 miles. I don't know how accurate the miles counting is because I do the silent mode, so. Instead of like jogging in place with your feet up, you like just squat. You do like mini squats and then you speed up to dash and then you do deeper squats for like high stepping. But I deserve it. I deserve a little soda. So that's my Ring Fit. Update of the day. Vibecut says, I bought the Ring Fit, but haven't had a chance to try it yet. It's very cool. I think today was week 16 for me. Hi. I'd always kind of based how I was feeling in the middle of it by, it'll tell you this active count. So it's like how much time you spend doing reps or doing like running or whatever. But this time I was like, I'm going to do it on real time instead. So I have a good sense of how much real time it was. It was about 2 hours. It was an hour 45 because I did take a little break in the middle there. But I also like was kind of surprised how inefficient that time is because you spend time in the menus and setting the skills. Anyway, Ring Fit Adventure. I recommend it. JC Cowan says I'm the fit boss. Oh no, I don't know about that. I haven't weighed myself since I've started doing it, and I'm not a person. I don't want to like get into a cycle of like weighing myself constantly, because that's not healthy. That stuff's not healthy. I hate everyone so shut up asks how Ring Fit's story is. It's really interesting. So like the idea is you are just some person and you find this ring on the ground and you pick it up and it's actually, oh, it's alive. And you also like have released this evil dragon, this buff dragon named Drago. And he's causing terror and releasing monsters and spreading dark influence. And so you have to go through these different worlds to beat him and sort of kind of figure out, because the other thing is that ring. So your ring, the ring is like its own character. So it has like a personality and it has a voice actor and all. And there's definitely like a history because the ring and Drago had been like workout partners for a long time. And so every time the two of them face up, there's always like little bits of like their history, and it's actually really interesting. The one I got today was like it was really short, but it was Drago being like, I remember when you had like your first love, your impossible love, and the ring got all awkward and it was really interesting. It was really weird and interesting. So anyway, Ring Fit Adventure, I recommend it. But pace yourself. You have to pace yourself. And it does have like difficulty levels for everybody of different activity ranges, body shapes, and so on. So that's that. What else? Yoshpunker says, I might be the only one, but I hate my Switch. It has the worst version of all these games. You know, I'm not going to disagree that like the Switch ports on stuff tend to just be the worst versions of things. Like, we played Eye the Somnium Files here on the Twitch channel, and especially at the end, you really feel it slog in terms of like just trying to look, like, because it loads up, it weirdly like loads up in scene moments when you're talking about stuff that happened in the past. So you have to wait, so a dialogue line ends and you hit the button and you have to wait for it to load up the scene in a pip. So it's not even like a black screen, you're just like waiting. And then it shows up, just so they can say, remember when we were at the shrine? Weird stuff like that. I mean, I do think the port stuff is bad, but also like, you know, Nintendo stuff, you gotta go for the first party stuff. Ring Fit Adventure looks and plays great. I've been playing Deus Ex Machina, which is fantastic. That's like an Armored Core type game. Astral Chain, I haven't played too much of it, but it looks really good. Though that's platinum. That's like a Switch exclusive, and it's platinum making that. But you know, any of the Mario stuff, Splatoon, like the first party stuff is really the where they make the best and smartest use out of the power. But yeah, if you're playing ports and stuff, it's not great. Speaking of the Twitch, over the weekend on Friday and Saturday, we had two great additions of Friday Night Bryce and Saturday Night Bryce. Was there a name for the Saturday one? I don't remember it. The big noon Saturday. Can we co-op that? Where we were playing Death Stranding live on stream, the new Hideo Kojima joint. I have really dug this game. Oh shit, I'm sorry, Justin. I'm sorry. I totally forgot to sign in this guy. I'm sorry. And it was a lot of fun. The first day we did it with Curly, and Curly was a trooper. And we ended up going like 7.5 hours. He even took a little cat nap in the middle of it. But that was a lot of fun. And then the next day we also did like 5 more hours of it. And then I've been playing it off stream. I've been trying to not do any story stuff. And when I do minor story stuff, I've been recording it. So the next time we play it on Friday, probably, we will... We'll start with about an hour of recorded footage of me doing some of the smaller story beats, so that we can get right into the big. Because I think we're getting close to the big new chapter transition, and that's when I've heard when stuff kind of goes off the rails a little bit. So give me one sec to make sure we got juice here on the right stuff. Output input. Okay, let's get my mans on the line. Juice. How's it going, man?
What up, fam?
Oh, not much. Just talking video games.
Oh man, is that what you guys do on Friday night, Bryce?
That's right.
big noon games. Big Saturday, America's game of the week is what your is. That's yours this weekend.
That's right. Yeah, man, I'm very excited. I've really been enjoying Death Stranding, but I've heard from people on some of the forums that like I'm in chapter 3 right now, and we're in the second like big open area of the game, and the thing that I heard is that like it's that the game like this is a. We're about at the cusp of where the game kind of turns a corner and is not as good.
Oh, really?
Just, I don't know what to take about that because everybody was saying that they didn't like the game ahead of time, or a lot of people were saying they didn't like it. So I don't know. I think it'll be okay, but there's certainly stuff, like I've heard combat becomes a bigger thing, and I know that combat's not great in Death Stranding. I don't know.
Really? Yeah. So it's just more frustrating in like not quite as contemplative and fun, and more like, oh, I need to do things that the mechanics aren't great on.
Well, and also like it sounds like gunplay becomes a little bit more of an issue, and the gunplay in the game so far has been serviceable.
Yeah.
But not always great. So I don't know, but
it's funny also because I remember, and this is again, I only know what people on my Twitter timeline are yelling at each other about. But like the second chapter was something that I saw. There was an idea that people wanted. They were encouraging people to speed through the second chapter.
Get right to the third chapter. Exactly. And that's where I'm still at. That's where I've spent, you know, a lot of that second day streaming and every day since then, where I was just playing on my free time, because that's when they start like giving you more and more things. There's like a roadblock at the end of chapter 2.
Kojima so far up his own ass with this one. Look, I don't know shit about ass when it comes to this dude, but all I know is I saw that trailer and he fucking told you exactly what he's like. Look, if you want something really fucking weird with Norman Reedus that you're effectively only buying because my name is on it, then come get some. And many people did. So,
I think it's been pretty accurate of you know what's on the tin, especially with that last trailer. And I think you know we said this a little bit. Maybe this was off the podcast during Weird Things yesterday. But like, you know, it's a lot of mainstream attention for a game that's not really designed to be mainstream. Hey, Brian.
Hey guys, I'm just gonna say that if you have the means to be sitting on a log, smoking a cigar, hand-selected by one of the finest consigliaries of all of Las Vegas, while you listen to a pre-release copy of Raise the Dead sitting next to a campfire, 34 degrees outside, highly recommended.
Pretty good.
Highly recommended experience. It's... Mm. I had a delightful past 45 minutes. We should probably do a show, though.
We can. We can. But all right. So did you finish episode two?
I ran out of time. Like, I'm in the last 5 minutes, yeah. And I'm just like, okay, at some point I'm the asshole. Like, yeah. Trying to be the good friend, I'm becoming the asshole. And so
That's fine. But good. You liked what you got up to.
Oh my God. I'm loving everything about it. The connective tissue, the constant back and forth to current relevance it's great. It's great.
Good. If you like it there, you're going to like it even more going forward. Good. All right. Yeah. Look, we're expanding. We're expanding the circle. So anybody wants it, don't worry. This is going to, I'm looking at it, a countdown day that I have been replacing every single day, and it is far lower than I want it to be. So you're going to get it a lot faster than you think. But yeah, it'll be out. It'll be out. And thankfully, people hate it.
What can I say? Can I say anything?
You can say what you want. Yeah. I mean, the podcast is the podcast.
Okay. Well, I mean, like, I don't know if anything.
I think the general premise is not a secret. You know, it's about the 1960 election, and it draws some parallels to the 2016 election.
Let me give you some get hype vibes here.
Yeah.
And I guess what I really want to do is sort of roll it back, because Justin sent me the 1.0 version of it. And I know the 1.0 version was like version 12 on Justin's side. But when he finally felt okay with sharing it, he sent me the 1.0 version. And one of the hardest things to do to a friend is give your honest opinion. And I felt like it was a bit straight. It was a straight history lesson. And there are good straight history lessons. This 2.0 shit is like fucking great. Like you could tell that Justin went into the woods, consulted with the goddess, and came back a changed man and realized, like, no, this is what this is meant to be. And the storytelling is great. It's authentic Justin, and yet like you could, if you wanted, just hand this over to somebody else to read, and yeah. It would still be, forgive me, just as good. Like it's Justin's writing, but it's not Justin performance. Does that make sense?
Yeah. It's not dependent on me selling it. Like, right. It is the work is there in the research and in the writing and in the structure.
Yeah. And the, yeah. And on top of that, it's weird too. I know that I'm accidentally underselling it because obviously if somebody is watching this feed right now, then they're a fan of Justin.
Yeah.
But this is going to be for everybody who has been waiting for the Justin centric thing that is easy to share with people who don't get Justin. Congratulations. Because this is it. It is
It'll
insightful,
very soon.
Witty and delightful. It's amazing. I'm so pleased and proud of you. And it's like, at this point, I'm not even going to give any more notes outside of our discussion that we just had, because everything after this, I'm just going to be enjoying for myself. I am unbelievably thrilled and proud and excited. It's fucking good. It's really good.
Dude. All right. Well, I'm very, very excited to hear that. All right. So here's the deal. It'll be a podcast series. I'll probably announce when it's going to come out soon, in the next week or two. Cause I don't have much more than that. it'll also be an ebook of the transcripts. And it will be, which I'm going to, it will not be an ebook like a narrative, because I do not have time to refashion it to be like an actual like book. It will be transcripts of the podcast, Raise the Dead.
It'll and be like lecture notes, a digital box set where it's like you get the whole thing.
And then there will be an audiobook, both the audiobook and the ebook will have another chapter that I cut from the podcast. So, Brian, between what is now episode 1 and 2 is a whole episode about the Chicago crime family and Frank Sinatra and their interactions with the Kennedy family that I cut just to keep everything. Like, I just made the decision that it all had to either revolve very directly around a Kennedy or a Nixon. But those will be bonuses in the ebook and the audiobook.
Is there anybody on an ongoing basis? I mean, the closest I can think of is like Hardcore History is very much telling you a history story, but every so often, you know, contextualizes things by saying it would be like if Lady Gaga ran for a comptroller or whatever. But you do something that I don't know that I've ever seen before, and it's a really good formula. This idea that you have two anchors and that you hold on to both anchors the entire story long, and they never wander too far away from each other. Is anybody else doing that?
I haven't heard it. If they do,
it's really good, Justin. Like I feel balanced the entire time, and you clearly announce, hey, let's look at this. Now let's jump back in time. Now we're back in this, and as a result, that moment that you realize that you're hearing the same story in different timelines is just extraordinary. I really, really dig it.
Well, thank you. I mean, the goal is to tell the story of the 1960 election, and you know what started out as just kind of a framing device of like, oh yeah, look, I mean, a lot of this stuff is kind of similar. Like look at all these things that were like kind of, you know, Trump's kind of a Kennedy figure, and Hillary's kind of a Nixon figure, and then you kind of just dig. The next episode that you're going to hear after this is about the conventions, and there are some very interesting corollaries between even sub characters in both dramas. There are kind of like these elements where the next episode is the one that I think you're really going to appreciate, because that is probably the boldest. And I think maybe the most clear thing that you can say is tracking is the movement of certain parties. I won't go any further than that, but you will hear it.
Well, and you do another good job of not overstating connections. Like if this was a conspiracy kind of story, you know, if you were going to overdo it, you could be all like, and the last name was both Quagmire for both of their secretaries. Like you don't get into that. Yeah. And in fact, when it gets coincidental enough that some storytellers might be tempted to play that game, you intentionally dial it back. Whereas just like, look, I mean, you know, part of this is just the way this game is run, but seriously, take a look at this. Who would have thought that who would have thought, like the opening thesis that the Trump campaign is more JFK like than I think anybody would have expected, you fucking deliver. Like that is that is an interesting thesis that I'm like, okay, go on, convince me. And two episodes in, I'll be like, I'll be goddamned if that's not the case. And I love the fact, this is not really a spoiler because it's in the first 5 minutes, but you say, I noticed a curious thing as I went exploring in the Donald Trump campaign forums. There's a weird infatuation with JFK. It's like, where is that coming from? And then the more you learn about JFK's campaign, you're like, holy fuck. Yeah, no, there's really strong connective tissue there. It's... Justin, I don't say this lightly. I think you did some real journalism. I'm really excited.
Fucking read enough. God, you know how much it's fucking actual. None of these are audiobooks. None of these fucking gigantic books are fucking audiobooks. You have to read all of them with your fucking eyes like an asshole.
Boo!
Ooh, it sucked. But Jesus. That'll be the worst part about this thing succeeding is me having to do more of them and having to read more books.
I mean, you realize that because you're going to hate it is why it will be a success.
Of course, I know. I'm just
there's a TV project that we're pitching, and it's only because I recognize what a giant inconvenience it'll be if this TV project were to take off that I am convinced that it will take off.
Yeah. All right. Well, number one, thank you, Brian. Bryce, how'd you like the first episode?
Now it begins.
I haven't had a chance to listen to it yet. I had to do my Ring Fit today.
Okay, yeah, sure, cool. Well, I mean, you're right. Nobody listens to podcasts while exercising.
Okay,
yeah,
man, all right,
look,
I've
Justin, you just won. You don't need to take a victory lap.
No, fuck you.
No, fuck you.
I shamed you into listening, and then you showered me with compliments for 45 minutes. So now I have the taste for blood. And
there was definitely, I was on the phone with Justin after I'd listened to the first episode, and I caught Andrew Heaton heading out in his car, and I walked on over, and I turned on my flashlight and pointed it at him. I'm like, sir, do you know why I stopped you? And he's like, what's going on? And I'm like, have you listened to Raise the Dead yet?
Yeah, I was planning on checking out tomorrow, but I am optimistic because I really did enjoy that first cut that you sent.
That first cut was dog shit. It's human garbage. Piece of crap. Some proto-human made that. Not the fucking that was pre-accident Dr. Manhattan work. Now we have the real work.
John Osterman. Do you think Dr. Manhattan's dick got bigger when he became Dr. Manhattan? Like, was John Osterman working with that kind of hog?
I think, I'll know this much, the legend of his dick has gotten bigger over time. I mean, who needs a suitcase to carry a blue dick? Somebody who remembers a dick as being maybe larger than it actually was.
Oh, the supplemental material says that was made as a mean joke by the Night Owl to Silk Spectre.
A mean?
Yeah, like he was trying to be mean to her because he believed that she was still hung up on her ex, and so he made her a gigantic blue dildo.
So
that's
is she,
supplemental material.
Is she complimenting the owl then?
No, the owl was like, oh, well, you fucking can't get over him. Here, fucking take this dick.
And so, I mean,
many questions that you would say, I would say in my own head. I'm just saying what's in the supplemental material that the HBO distributes.
Distributes in the form of a newsletter or?
No, they have like the PDpedia. So Dale Peaty, that character, apparently runs this like site where they publish like news clippings and old transcripts and stuff like that. So if you go to Watchmen PDpedia each week, they have supplemental information. And that was this week's, was the origin and diagram of how the Dr. Manhattan dildo was made.
Before we start the show proper, do you feel like you're in a safe place to express where you're at on that show? Because I know that it is a precious property to you, and I don't want to.
And
be
if the
playful.
Answer is yes, actually save it because we have someone asking about it for the show, or if you'd like to talk about it on the show.
Oh yes. Okay. Yeah. No. Is it an email?
Yeah.
Or
okay.
The email?
So we yeah. okay. Just know that friend to friend, I recognize that there are things that are too precious to be played with, and I will not get you fired up.
All right. Can I just say that right now I am in love with your relationship with your hair.
God, it's fucking great.
Your relationship with your hair is adorable and mesmerizing. Because you definitely just went into a good friend Brian moment of like, hey, I just want to make sure boundaries. But you had just, because you can't help it, fidgeted your hair into a perfect troll doll quaff.
It was just standing, just very Yahoo serious-esque, fucking right up there. And it was fucking great. It was amazing.
Dan33's got it right. You're doing kind of a Jimmy Neutron.
Yeah, I'm getting there. I'm getting there.
I did not watch The Mandalorian. Brian or Bryce, did you watch The Mandalorian today?
I did not. No. I heard, in fact, I'm boycotting Disney Plus because I heard that despite all their advertisements of all this National Geographic content, they unfairly have excluded certain controversial content, stuff too hot. Mm-hmm. Hashtag too hot for Disney Plus.
Wait, are you telling me they don't have Brain Games on there?
But they do. They also have.
Oh, they do have Brain Games on there?
They do. They do have Brain Games. Yeah, but weirdly, the show that universally held on to the audience that Brain Games had and built on it in the second hour, for some reason, too hot. They couldn't handle it.
Hmm. Do you think that legitimately could, like, isn't it on Amazon right now? Couldn't it be because there's like a bunch of Marvel movies that are not on.
That's
it.
Right. That's why I'm all Amazon Prime. Actually,
So you think that as licenses expire, that they will come home to Disney Plus?
Mm-hmm. No, it's good because I didn't want to be on there anyway.
You're on the one that you like.
I know. That's the end of it. Like I breathed a huge sigh of relief.
That maybe they had to delete all of the hacking the systems so they could make room for the racist crows and Dumbo.
Yeah, man. In fact, I forgot. Now that I'm glad you mentioned that, because I wrote a little note. I said, "Hey, it's your network. Do whatever you want. But if you're gonna bring back racist crows and Dumbo, then I'd just as soon you not put my show with Jason Murphy on there." That's.
And they said, "Please don't leave." And you said, "I'm a man of principle. Damn it, Brian, Jason Aaron."
I hear Mandalorian's good. I don't know. You said you hadn't watched any of it, Justin?
I haven't. I've gotten the worst review I got was it's a little wackier than I thought, but it was good. Mm. That was the worst review. And then I had my buddy who has hated all the Disney Star Wars stuff just text me, good Star Wars. So he liked it. Somebody who hated Force Awakens, despised Last Jedi, liked Mandalorian.
Did you guys see this? That apparently,
McCluskey.
McCluskey.
McCluskey. Wait, Brian, have you seen this?
No. What's going on?
George Lucas.
Well, here. Why don't we just play it?
Play it.
Right. So, the infamous scene from the Star Wars where. The guy's in the bar, and he's like, "Hey,
the guy,
I'm the guy." Okay, here it is. Where's my audio?
By the way, solid Twitch strategy, just showing Star Wars footage.
Okay, hold on, give me a second. I gotta find out why I can't.
They
might have muted it.
Is the Han shot Greedo re-edit the first time that Star Wars fandom got like self-righteous? Was that the opening salvo of like, now, no, we are the fans. We fucking own this property. Do not fuck with our shit.
Yeah, because I mean, right,
here,
we
hold on. Here we go. Here we go.
Ugh, I don't know why this is so quiet. It's hard to make out because I don't know why everyone decided to record this on their phone so you can't hear what he's saying, but Greedo now says McClunky before he shoots Han.
Whoa. Sorry. So not only did they edit the scene to have Greedo shoot first, they added a line of dialogue that did not exist there before.
Okay. Yeah. So here's the timeline, right? The initial thing is Han shot first.
Yeah.
Oh, no. So Han shot first.
In the beginning, became, Han,
yeah,
a rogue scoundrel.
Han shoots first.
Yeah.
In the special edition, Greedo shoots first. There's like a beat, and then, and then Han fucking moves awkwardly, and then Han shoots him back, right? Then the DVD editions had it kind of to be a simultaneous fire. Now, Disney Plus, it adds the war cry of Greedo, of him saying, McCunky.
What? God damn it. What are you doing? What are you doing?
So apparently this is from the 4K re-release from... apparently this was from a 4K re-release that they made recently. But that fool definitely says McClunky.
Although I will say, of all the changes... it's the best of the changes because it establishes the fact that he says something establishes the motive to do it, as opposed to how it was very obviously originally shot that Han is just the baddest motherfucker on the planet and just ices this like dickhead in the bar. At least this establishes that Greedo is bad at his job and the kind of fuckwad that would yell before he shoots somebody, and Han is just a bad motherfucker.
The separate thing that I see in a related article over there, you saw that Jeopardy clip.
The
number
the,
two over the there in popular culture, Bonnie. I don't think you've seen this.
Oh,
here, take a look at this.
Sure, this is also on Slate.
What?
This was a very, very, very sweet moment.
So maybe if you can. Okay.
He writes down McClunky.
Drew, you're smiling. I like that. Let's take a look at your response. Did you come up with the right one? No? What is we love you out? That's very kind. Thank you. Costs you $19.95. Left with $5. Okay.
Oh, God,
let's go to Kyle Jones now. He wrote something down, then paused. He started off with what is other half lives. Yeah, you're right. What was your wager? 4,401. That takes you into a $1 lead over Emma. She had 19,200, led for most of the game, and wrote down the correct response. Did she wager more than a dollar? Yes. All right, Emma, way to go. You're coming back later this week to play for a quarter mil. And we're coming back tomorrow with 3 semifinalists. Join us then.
Aww. What do you think the backstory was?
He's dying.
Well, he is surviving cancer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pancreatic cancer, right? Thought it was gone. It's back. So he just said, "We love you, Alex." That was sweet.
Yeah, but no, it's really resonated. It was like I checked like the trending videos on YouTube, and it was the new Sonic trailer, and that people were really into the empathy of somebody, you know, really paying tribute to the ledge, Trebek.
Are we still angry at Sonic?
No, he looks great now.
No, Sonic. Oh no, have you not heard? Sonic is now redeemed. Now the Sonic movie is the greatest movie of all time, and not a bizarre piece of trash.
I'll be the judge of that.
Wait, have you not seen the trailer?
Oh, yeah, you hadn't seen it. Oh,
no, okay. I haven't seen it.
I just read somebody said it's cute now. Not
yeah,
weird.
It is cute now. Oh my goodness! Can someone? Here we go. Here we go, Sonic the Hedgehog.
Well, that looks like the cartoon character.
Handsome package. On my
so apparently,
planet, people were always after
apparently
my
they tapped the animator of the Sonic Mania animation to sort of lead the redesign. The Sonic Mania animation is widely regarded as very, very well done.
It does look a lot better.
Yeah.
I don't hate that him. Guy.
You know, I never saw the first one.
Oh.
I know. I heard everybody talking about it. My kids were talking about it.
But yeah, I also think like just the trailer itself is just way better.
Well, here,
than that last
one. A few things are happening. Also, pause it right there.
Okay.
Go right back to when he's in the dark, and you will see an unfinished CGI Sonic, a very hilariously unfinished.
Yeah, his shade is not quite right on that one.
It looks like fucking South Park, like just randomly in the background.
That's like the, did you ever see that footage from Rogue One where the guy who played Wash is definitely just wearing a CGI suit before they had painted him over?
That's hilarious.
It's amazing. Like there's a totally unfinished.
Oh, that's the first one.
Yeah.
Oh, so much better.
Well, and also Bryce, to your point, it's a much better trailer in that now the story is this like heightened cartoonish version of E.T. He's an alien that's on Earth that winds up coming into contact with a human, but the story is always kind of told from his point of view, which I guess is not like E.T., but this is not just a random human runs into an alien kind of situation.
Yeah. And maybe it's because there's less dialogue in this trailer versus that first one, but just it lands so much better. I think, even though it's all very different parts of the film compared to the first trailer.
Yeah, the jokes are also funnier.
Yeah,
there's also that, which I almost wonder whether or not that was part of it. Is that they're like, okay, we actually do have a decent movie here. We can't have it fucking just totally capsized by this horrifying creative decision that was made.
Yeah.
Yeah. I guess they were wanting to make him look like he had a 5 o'clock shadow or something. Like
the idea was, I mean, I don't know what the concept initially was, just like, oh no, we need to make him more realistic, like an animal.
Yeah.
He looks more fuzzy and
it also looks a little bit more unkempt. And here's what really is the creepiest is the hands. The hands on the first one are smaller and are therefore a little bit more expressive.
Yeah.
If you actually, Bryce, if you go to Gene Park's Twitter.
Oh, I was actually just trying to pull up the original trailer. Who am I looking at them?
Gene Park, G-E-N-E Park. He's works for the Washington Post. But if you scroll down a bit, he's got just a GIF of that exact startled scene. And the biggest thing that you notice is that the smaller and more expressive hands just look so much fucking creepier compared to like the bigger Mickey Mouse kind of gloves that are just like by their very nature a little bit more still, and therefore your eyes aren't drawn to them. Like there is like a fucking actual study to be done on why that the creepy Sonic is creepy and why the fucking new Sonic is great.
Justin, I hate the Washington Post website now. I hate it. Their odd stuff is the worst.
Oh wait, did you actually get sucked into the website itself?
It's not on his Twitter, is what I'll say.
Oh, right.
So I'm now looking at an ad for Lorex security cameras and not the GIF that I was seeing like a minute ago. So
But okay, no,
here we go.
Yeah.
And it's I think what I had heard was some internet detective went through and looked at some of the stuff and believed that I guess maybe they had done motion capture for the original Sonic, and it seems that they may have thrown that out and reanimated him, which I could see them do in some scenes, but it does seem like a lot of data to be lost rather than just building off original data. But who knows?
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. And that was kind of a heartwarming story because, like, that's an example of, you know, just a very, very shit upon project that instead of just, like, you know, one of the most common things on the internet is just like, oh, another shitty video game movie. Mm-hmm. I guess everyone's going to get really pumped up for this video game movie. And guess what? It's going to blow because video games have not had the comics moment where people are like, oh, shit, let's treat these things really fucking good and seriously, and they can be fucking amazing movies.
Well, and think about the number of stories in our collective heads that begin with the opening act being fan outrage and end with a happy ending.
Yeah, right? Like this was...
That just doesn't happen.
I want to... I don't know if I'll go see it because it just looks like kind of a basic kids movie, but I want this to succeed. I want the Sonic movie to really succeed because I want people to say like, oh, wait, maybe internet outrage isn't just a liability. Maybe sometimes internet outrage is like, oh, yeah, this is a garbage design. Because the playbook, I talked about this on the Jury podcast, but the normal playbook for this movie would have been put this thing out, totally ignore the fact that people hate it, then make it about, oh, a few internet fans are upset about it, but mm-hmm. the vast majority of Sonic fans are very excited to speed to the theaters.
Especially because that has been Sonic, the video game strategy of releasing video games for the past decade, right? Short of Sonic Mania, which was made by a different person doing an old style game. It's always been the hardcore people buying Sonic Colors and Sonic... what was the last one? Blast? Sonic? No. Well, all these other bad Sonic games that they keep pumping out. And so it's good to see that they didn't let that happen with the movie.
Yeah, because they definitely, like... and I think I read a little bit of Gene Park's article on this in the Post, but, like, it is kind of a rich, like, wrinkle that it's Sonic that gets this treatment. That, like, of all properties... It's the Sonic movie where people are like, oh, fuck, we totally made a mistake. Let's go back and fix it before we embarrass ourselves, because that has been preciously absent in any other Sonic project writ large.
And I bet, because they make like animated Sonic series, right? There's a Sonic Colors animated series that is supposed to be really, really well done and well written. And I could imagine where if a movie with an animated Sonic comes out and it's bad, how that would probably negatively affect these, by all reports, good Sonic, you know, cartoons.
Yeah.
Justin or Brian or Bonnie, did any of you guys see this clip?
No.
No.
This is a weird one. This is a weird one. And I think it's very funny. People in the chat, let me know if you've seen this one. The tweet goes, no one, colon, and then 2005, colon, and it's this video.
Host the show, I'm not going to dance, okay?
Hold up. I don't think you should be saying that, not until you hear this.
Do the dog catch a baby, do the dog catch a baby.
Let's go.
So, for audio listeners, we're seeing Diddy refuse to dance. Oh, until he does.
But that's how
that skeptical
I dance.
Clapping, though. Everybody's very skeptically clapping.
Oh my god. No, this is actually, hey, can you bring up the dance I did at Night Attack a long time ago? Like
it
this
just,
is similar.
It just cut
very
it with
similar.
All of these reactions.
Because that's about the same.
Oh. That
what I okay.
Is it looping or is it?
So that's the thing, is that this is definitely a very heavily edited video for some reason.
Right.
Oh. What is happening?
I'm uncomfortable. What's going on?
I don't know. This tweet like took off the other day, and I love it. Like the weird song choice that's definitely not the original song. All the reactions to the celebrities of 2005.
Oh my god!
Like, and Pete Wentz right there.
Benji.
Oh They'll remember how you danced. They won't remember what you said. They won't.
It's the same.
Anyway.
I guess it feels like you had to have been there, kind of thing. Wait, what was the event?
That was some MTV Music Award.
Oh.
That's amazing. That is sublime.
I think they were there too.
they probably were there, clapping nervously.
Yeah.
Clapping nervously.
All right, it's 9:01. If anybody needs to go get a drink or take a break before we start the show, you should probably go do that now.
Yeah, no, I'm feeling it.
Mm-hmm. All right, you keep the
Babe.
Got it.
Well, Brian,
I was so hoping, Bonnie. I stood there way too long. I was hunkered around that campfire. I set up that campfire and I lit a cigar and I listened to Justin's podcast. And I was just like, any minute now, Bonnie's gonna come around and she's just gonna see me looking, so suave and buff and thoughtful, contemplative, historical. And then eventually I got cold and came inside.
Sorry, you missed out.
No, it's all right.
That fire, though, is going pretty good.
Oh,
is it still off?
Should I have not left it unattended?
There's, especially with the fence where everybody can drive by and see that we left an unattended.
All right, I'll go put out the fire. I'll be right back.
Literally, let's not die in a fire, okay?
Right. Hey, Bonnie.
Hi, how are you?
Good, how are you doing?
I'm good. Yeah, I had to ground a bunch of kids at the house. Ooh. They were not
acting right.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And there's a little bit of property damage.
Oh, boy, Jesus.
We are really in trouble. And so not only are the kids grounded, but I realize when you ground kids, you're basically grounding yourself too. Because then, like, you have to.
Oh, you have to like be on duty.
Everything.
Yeah.
Yeah. But
how much was the property? Do you know how much damage they did?
I'm not quite sure yet, and I'm not comfortable talking about it because angry still. But like the funny part is the Josie totally, you know, she's the middle child, and I was like, and then broke something, and then I was like, whoa. You do not understand the value of a dollar, and you are going to have to work minimum wage for me so you understand. Like, she goes, I'll just go get my babysitting money. I'm like, oh, no, that's easy money, honey. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about what real money is like. Mm-hmm. So she's sweeping and doing the dishes and doing all this. You know, I mean, she does those things anyways, but then now it's, like, with this, like, unmerciful intense.
Yeah.
And then meanwhile, Penny, I'm like, and you need to cool the heck down, so you have to go exercise and do cardio.
The kids, they were fighting with each other?
Yeah, fighting with each other. So then, they both got, you know, their own punishment. But then Penny, like a freaking punk-ass kid, you know, she's 15. So I'm like, okay, so you need to exercise in your life, girl. You got to go out there. You release this tension. You won't be so like, you know, when your sister's being weird.
Yeah.
So you have to, you know, you won't get your devices back till you exercise this many hours or whatever.
Okay. So like, running or.
Yeah. So something? Running or biking or whatever. And then, so today she goes out in her flip flops and shorts.
Oh, no, I can't do that. It's like 30 degrees outside.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
Right? And then she comes back in and she goes, well, it's not like, it's not like it's freezing outside. Nothing could happen to me. I'm like.
I mean.
It is freezing.
And also, like if you were, like, doing, like, a full-on jog or whatever, you would probably raise your body temperature enough where it wouldn't be a big deal. But she's a young girl who probably doesn't go. You know,
she wore flip flops, so she's not jogging anywhere.
That's
right?
what I'm saying. Yeah. It's like you could have made that excuse if these other things, if, you know, she wasn't wearing flip-flops.
I know. So her legs were, like, bright red when she came in. Mm-hmm. I'm, like, trying not to worry about it. Like, you know.
Justin, you ever get grounded? You ever get grounded juice?
Oh, shit, yeah. My God. I was a sassy young man.
Yeah?
Well, also, I didn't really get grounded all that much. I pissed off my mom royally once, but it was... You know, by and large, my mom, for at least the early part of my life, was a single mom. So, we all kind of stuck together. There was certainly an understood order of like how stuff was gonna go.
Hmm.
But then later, yeah, no, I certainly was, you know, pushing boundaries.
And, yeah.
You know, grounded for things. Although there was a lot less to take away back when I was a youngin. You know, like, sure. I mean, maybe, you know, like if
TV
our bar
time or.
Yeah. But even then it's like, OK, how much do they really want to come in and like fucking put their ear up against my door to make sure I'm not silently watching television, which is what I would definitely do, or, you know, stuff like that. It's like that's a little bit less, or at least it would take a lot more effort and a lot more active front of mind. Like thinking than just like, give me that phone, yoink, you get it back when you're not a bitch. Like, you know, that's that I think is there's more stuff. There's gradients like to the enforcement gradients in a way that there was not before because you have the devices, I feel.
Okay. Mm. Yeah. Yeah.
Before it was like, all right, either like you have to do something so bad that you can't leave your room. Right? Right. Or you have to do chores. I guess I got a lot of chores. That was where I would like, hey, if you screw up, go do this.
So like, you weren't already just like doing chores because you were a kid?
No, we would, but if we screwed up, then we'd have to do something extra. We'd have to like, you know, clean the oven or something like do something that like you would all the time. It wouldn't just be like cleaning out the trashes or, you know, cleaning the bathroom and stuff like that. It would be more stuff like that. Although much more so, I got kicked out from doing something. Usually playing video games or watching TV. Mm-hmm. I got that was like stopped. And one time, me and my brother watched Wayne's World so much that my stepfather stole the tape and wouldn't give it back.
Wayne's World.
Oh my God! We burnt that motherfucker out. Holy shit!
I feel like you probably I don't know, because I had that with The Nightmare Before Christmas, right? Just like a movie that as a kid you just like have this attachment to and you watch it a million times. I don't know. Did you have anything like that, Bonnie? Just something that you just watched a million times as a kid?
No, because, you know, I'm old. So we had like a Betamax, but we didn't have like tapes. You know,
yeah, pre ubiquitous home video, right? There are probably Blockbusters around, but certainly not a Blockbuster on every corner, and we are miles away from any kind of streaming service.
Right, right. Mm-hmm. We had like a little convenience store that had like a little tape place, and they would switch them out sometimes. But yeah, no, there was no me being able to record shows or do any of that kind of stuff. So yeah. Apparently, your friend Justin here had watched Wayne's World so much with his brother that his stepdad took it away.
he stole the Wayne's World tape. And we're like, hey, we want to go watch Wayne's World. Have you seen it? And he's like, yeah, I stole it. I'm not going to give it back because you've watched it 50,000 fucking times in the last 48 hours.
So, like, what would that equivalent be with our children?
Oh, well, My Little Pony for each of them.
I mean, but have you had to take it away from him?
Yes.
What was the one that
Josie and Callie start talking like some of the characters, and they start getting all sassy.
Too much sass.
And then the worst is like some of them like kind of get screamy about things, and then I'm like,
Yeah. One time I got punished in school because I had watched Fern Gully that weekend, and one of the characters, when asked if his name is his name, and I can't remember the name of the character, replies, last time I checked. And so during attendance, they said, Justin, and I go, last time I checked. And it was like...
Oh, my God.
Yeah. Death fell over the classroom, and the eye of Sauron fucking landed on me.
I remember in elementary school, it was lunchtime, and I had just learned how to snap my fingers. And I was in the lunch line, and I was snapping my fingers because I just learned how to do it, and the lunch lady got mad at me.
Because really she bad. Thought you were saying,
yeah,
pick up the pace, lady.
Right. So that stunk.
Hey, so turns out my limit is one. I should only have one cigar.
Did you have
Did you go out there and have two?
Like if I have half a cigar and then drop it and then think that's okay, I'll just start another one. I shouldn't do that.
Oh, no.
Should have just said half a cigar. That was enough.
Yeah.
That's the cool thing about a cigar is that even when you get halfway through, you can just kind of let it burn and it will slowly go away.
Yeah, but like it drops on the ground and it's like, well, I don't want to take this dusty, dirty cigar. I'll just start a new fresh one. And also, this one will last long enough that my wife will see me hanging out by a campfire.
Oh, that's the problem.
And then all of a sudden, you know, she does see you and she tells you, go put out that campfire. And, and then you walk outside and the physical exertion of walking out there kind of you're barfing a little bit, and then and then you realize I should only have one cigar.
Oh, is that how you put the fire out?
It's certainly how I put out the romantic fire is by burping a little bit.
Dude, we got a case of the burps lately, me and you.
Oof. Yeah.
Oh, you know.
What could that possibly mean?
Sometimes a cigar is just a cigar, Brian.
Yeah. Hmm. And sometimes it's vomiting on your compound. Discreetly.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, sometimes you got to let your compound know who's boss. Like, just a, hey, man, just in case you forgot. That's a mouthful for you.
All righty. You guys want to do a show?
Yeah. Feeling it.
Let's do it.
All right. I'm going to click a few buttons here and do us the show.